Thanks for joining us today at Lighthouse Outreach Ministries. We're lighting the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, listen today as Pastor Green shares some biblical truths that will shine upon the true light, Jesus Christ.
We're going to begin in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 11. He says that you study to be quiet. I didn't know you had to study to be quiet. But the Bible says we need to study to be quiet and to do your own business and to work with your own hands as we commanded you. This is the Apostle Paul speaking to the church at Thessalonica. And he said, this is what I want you to do. I want you to study to be quiet. I want you to do your own business. I think that means mind your own business. Amen. How many of you know some people like to get in other people's business? But the Bible says mind your own business. How many of you know we got enough business to take care of with ourselves without being in everybody else's business? It says mind your own business and work with your own hands. Everybody lift up your hands. The Bible says these were made to work with. This is what we need to do. Work with your own hands as we commanded you. Now, when the apostles are speaking, they are the ones that are telling the church the order of God. And this is the order that the apostles commanded the churches to do. Now, these are still relevant to us today. We're the church of today, and they're the apostles of old. And just because they've gone on to be with the Lord doesn't mean that their words are not relevant. In fact, their words are very relevant to us. I look at this verse and I say, this is my responsibility to study to be quiet, to mind my own business, and to work with my own hands. That is a commandment of God through the Apostle Paul to the church of Thessalonica and the church that would believe on them throughout the generations, meaning us. Verse 12, now he tells us why he has commanded us to do such. He says, so that you may walk honestly toward them that are without, and that you may lack of nothing. So when we mind our own business and we work with our own hands, then we're going to be living honorably and honestly before those that are without, are lacking. And then we're going to have the things that we need supplied because we're willing to work for it. Amen? See, some people have their hands stuck out. They do not want to go to work. We live in a country today that so many people think they were born here to be given something on a silver platter. They expect somebody to pay their way in life, to feed them and to pay their housing allowances or housing, to give them things and take care of them. Many are expecting the government that is in debt, trillions of dollars, to send them a check in the mail each month and supply for all of their needs. There's many people that are just living off of the government who is in debt, and those are taxes that those who worked paid into the government. Amen? Because that's where that money comes from. That money came from people who were willing to work and who were willing to pay in taxes. According to the law, we're to pay taxes. And then the government takes that money and stewards it. And I think they're doing a poor job in many areas, I will say, because I believe they're throwing away many of our tax dollars to people who are not in need but are too lazy and slothful to get up off their rear ends and go to work. And if you offered them a job, they wouldn't take it anyway. They don't want a job. There's many don't want a job. And I tell you what, they're out of order. It is called out of order. It is not of God. It is not a commandment of God that you should be slothful and lazy and unwilling to work. If you ain't willing to work now, you won't ever be willing to work. It's something to do with your character and the who you are that says, I don't want to go to work. I want somebody else to pay my way. I tell you what, I reckon my parents must have raised me right in that area. because they raised me to work. They taught me that it was honorable to work. And from the time I was 15, I went out and got me a job. I wanted to work. You know why? Because I wanted to pay my way. I didn't want to have to go to mom and daddy and ask them for everything I needed. Now, some kids could care less about asking mama and daddy to give them everything. But a good child wants to help, not depend on someone else. Oh, it's quiet in here this morning. I want you to turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. I don't know how far I'm going to get. God may have me continue this in 2 or 3 sessions. I'm not going to get in a hurry because I'm going to go at the speed that I received it in. And that may take, you know, it took me several hours to get it. So I probably won't hold you to that kind of standard. But if we don't finish it today, we'll finish it whenever the Lord wills in the next time we meet. But I want you to turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. And we're going to look starting in verses, 6. Okay. Now what we have here is Paul's letter. It's the second epistle that Paul the Apostle, now that's a mouthful, it's the second epistle of Paul the Apostle, that he wrote to the church in Corinth. And so he's making his conclusion of his appeal to the church here. And he begins to point out the benefits that the Corinthians will reap as a result of generously giving. So I want you to open your heart right now and begin to just see what God says about what will happen to you if you're a generous giver. There's good things for those who give generously. So we're going to start in verse 6. Paul said these words, "But this I say, he which soweth sparingly shall reap also sparingly, and he which soweth bountifully shall reap also bountifully. Every man, according as he purposeth in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. As it is written, he has dispersed abroad, he has given to the poor. His righteousness remaineth forever. Now he that ministereth seed to the sower, both ministers food, bread for your food, and multiplies your seed sown," say seed sown, "and increases your fruits of your righteousness." When something's sown, something increases. What do you see there? When your seed is sown, what increases? The fruits of your righteousness increases. Wow. Somebody say, wow. "Being enriched in everything," say everything, "to all bountifulness, which causeth through us thanksgiving to God. For this, the administration of this service not only supplieth the wants of the saints, but is abundant also by many thanksgivings unto God. Whilst by the experiment of this ministration, they glorify God for your professed subjection unto the gospel of Christ, and for your liberal distribution unto them and unto all men, and by their prayer for you, which long after you for the exceeding grace of God in you, thanks be unto God for his unspeakable gift." Amen. Amen. Lord, just help us to get today what you're trying to say to us through these verses, Lord. So I want to point out to you this morning that He's pointing out to the Corinthians the benefits that they will reap for being generous givers. It's a way of giving that he expresses in this. God loves a cheerful giver. That means someone that gets excited about their giving. Someone that's apt to give. Somebody that doesn't give begrudgingly or of necessity or under compulsion. He wants you to just freely give, because freely we've received, freely we're to give. And he wants us to be cheerful about our giving. Paul sums it up in these words. Whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. He who sows generously, abundantly, will what? Reap generously and abundantly. So really what he's saying is you'd establish how you want to reap by how you give. You and I are over how we want to reap in this area of charitable giving. Now what he's talking about here is charitable giving. And he says, you establish, how do you want to reap? Some people says, well, what should I give? The question should be, what do you want? How much do you want? What kind of harvest do you want? That should be your question. If we gave, after asking that question, most every one of us in this room would increase our giving. Not because of anything except how many of us wouldn't like to have more, because if we have more, then we're able to even give more. You can't give what you don't have. When we have more, we have more to give. I've been without. How many else has been without in here? Does it feel good? It don't feel like God either. It felt like the devil. Come on. When you're getting your lights cut off, when you can't pay your house payment, you can't pay your light bill, when you're under the press and the pressure and the stress of lack, and you don't have enough, and you got more month than you got money, and there's not enough food in the cupboard, come on, it's nothing funny about it. It can add to you so much undue stress and pressure on you. A lot of people are just a nervous wreck because of things to do with financial pressures. Do you know what I'm talking about? But the Bible has much to say about it. The Bible, almost every chapter in this Bible, is filled with teachings about financial matters. Jesus taught a lot about financial matters. The apostles taught about it. Like him, Paul used all these verses to talk about your giving. Now, you know, I don't stand up here and teach a lot about giving. I was trying to remember this morning when was the last time I actually taught and used time in a service to talk about our giving and our reaping. And I can't recall the last time I even really did that in a teaching. A lot of times I'm teaching on the cross, or I'm teaching on sanctification or the baptism of the Holy Spirit, or you know, whatever. But for some reason, God's saying this is the relevant word for the hour. So it reappears. We see it reappear, and you don't have to turn there, but I know you know this scripture. It's in Galatians 6:7. It says, a man reaps whatever he sows. A man reaps whatever he sows. So you sow sparingly, what are you going to reap? If you say, well, I'm going to put a little bit in, I'm going to give a little bit, then you're going to get a little bit back. But it says he who sows generously is going to get a generous harvest back. It is a law called reciprocity. The law of reciprocity is a law of God, and it has to work. If it doesn't work, why should you believe anything else in this Bible? If this law of God doesn't work, I would tell you none of the rest of the Bible should work. If give and it shall be given unto you, pressed down, shaken together, running over of good measure, men shall give into your bosom, don't work. then none of the rest of the Bible should be adhered to or believed in. How many of you tried God? The Lord said, even in Malachi, in the Old Testament, He said, there's a curse upon the land because men have robbed God. And the men said, wherein have we robbed God? And God said, in the tithes and in the offerings, you've robbed me. And He said, because of it, there's a curse on the entire land. He showed them the difference between giving to God what rightfully belongs to God. The difference between the blessing and the curse. You want to see the blessing and the curse? Go to Deuteronomy 28. It affects every part of your life. Your health, your soul salvation, your finances, everything. The Old Testament speaks of it, not just the New Testament. We can go back, like I said, in Malachi. The solution that He sent for the prophet Malachi was, bring your tithes and offerings into my storehouse that there may be meat in my house. So what the people were doing in Malachi's day, they were not giving God the tithe, which was the first tenth of their income, and they were neglecting to give the offerings, which were over and above the tithes, and they were not bringing it into the house of God to take care of the work of the Lord and support those that were called into full-time ministry and to support the house of God and to make sure that the money was there taking care of, as we would call it today, the church and the ministers. And so the Lord said to Malachi, go tell them that there's a curse on them. But He said, tell them to try me and prove me in this one thing. There's one place that I found in the Bible, God said, you test me. You try me in this. Bring your tithes and offerings into my house. That there, for the mere reason of this, that there can be meat in my house. That the meat of the word can be in my house. That there can be substance in my house. He said, try me in this. Prove me. See if I will not open up the windows of heaven over you and pour you out blessings to which you can't even contain it all. He said, try me. So we see it in the Old Testament in Job 4:8. We see it again in Proverbs 11, 24 through 26. We see it in Proverbs 22, 8 and 9. We see it in Hosea 10, 12 through 13. And in Malachi. That's just a few of the verses. We don't have time to look them all up. But the teaching I want to tell you that I want to expound on, first of all, in addition to Paul's, which I highly respect Paul. I love Paul's teachings. He is the apostle of apostles to me. God allowed him to write more books of the New Testament. If you don't like what Paul says, you don't like Jesus. If you don't like what Paul says, you don't like God. Because this man wrote most of the New Testament that we know today. But listen to Jesus. You say, well, you just tell me what Jesus has to say about it, because I just don't know about Paul and Malachi and all those prophets and those apostles. Well, let's see what Jesus says. Turn to Luke 6:38 and hold your place in 2 Corinthians. Is your Bible got it in red letters? Okay, that means these are actual quotes from the mouth of Jesus. Jesus said, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure. Pressed down, shake it together, running over, shall men give into your bosom. Now, when a man gives unto your bosom, it means he gives it to you, he puts it in your hand, you put it in your bosom. Come on. Hallelujah. Y'all women know about that? Okay, we'll lose the visual. For with the same measure that you meet with all, it shall be measured to you again. So all Jesus is saying is if you give a little, you'll receive a little. Whatever measure you give, if you give a greater measure, what are you going to receive? A greater measure. Jesus confirmed with his own words what giving will do for you. You know, I have stood on that so many times. I'll say, Lord, I have an area that I have a need in. And the Lord will say, give. Give, and it shall be given unto you. And then I'll say, okay, Lord, you said if I have a need, if I have any area of my life that I have a lack and a need, that I need to give. And it shall be given unto me. And so with faith and obedience, I sow a faith seed. I'll just sow a seed into the church. I'll just put it, write a check. And I'll say, okay, God, I'm going to write this check and just for the area of where I'm having some lack, and I'm going to put it in the offering plate. I'm going to put it in your storehouse. Amen? It don't mean you need to go out and do alternate things with it. I've heard people say, well, I took it and gave some food to so-and-so. It doesn't say that we need to do that. Charitable giving is to give where the word of God is preached to the preachers who are preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's what charitable giving is about, is supporting the gospel of Jesus Christ. So I've done it. So I cannot tell you if God, and I'm sure he has this, God has an accounting book. In that accounting book is your name. Under your name is every time you have ever given for the gospel. Every time you have ever given for the gospel, he has a record book. I've been saved over 18 years. I don't know how much I've given. I have no idea, and I'm not trying to keep track. But I tell you, God knows what seeds I've sown. He knows the giving. He knows the sacrifice. He knows everything about what you've given and what it's cost. You say, well, nobody else in the church knows what I've done. Let me tell you, the one that's the head of the church knows what you've done. And I tell you what, he's the one you'll receive your reward from. If you've given unto the Lord, from the Lord you will receive a reward. It's coming. There's a reward for prayer. There's a reward for fasting. I tell you this morning, there's a reward for giving. You cannot deny this, that there is a reward for giving. It's clear in the scriptures. The principle is this. We harvest in proportion to our planting. Now, that's what a farmer does. Does a farmer harvest in proportion to his sowing? Amen. His labor's involved in it. How many of you know, if you look at a farmer, he gets up and he goes to work and he buys a field. And then he has to prepare the field. And he has to go out and labor in the field. And he has to get that field ready to put that seed down in. And it's a lot of sweat and tears. It's a lot of long hours and long days. Hard work. Then he's ready to put his seed in the ground. Because he's anticipating his harvest. I believe he's thinking about what it's going to take, what he's going to need. He's not just looking at the day. Have you ever met people who the only thing they think about is, well, today we okay. They never think about what we're going to need. Well, when you begin sowing, you begin to think about what you're going to need for your future, not just now. Even it's sowing in anticipation of a harvest that is to come. When you sow, there is an anticipation that rises up within you. There is an excitement. When I sow a seed, I get excited. Now, some people get mad when they sow seeds. I don't get mad. I get real excited because I am anticipating a harvest. I know if I sow into the kingdom of God, it is the best soil there is. It guarantees a return 30, 60, or even 100 times as much. The Bible guarantees. Do you have a guarantee in anything else? Is there anything this world has that has a guarantee of a return on it? Stock market? Well, I'm just investing my money all over here. We harvest in proportion to our planting. We reap in proportion to our sowing and our giving, in charitable giving. I want to give you some guidelines from 2 Corinthians 9, verse 7. If you will, look at verse 7 again. In 2 Corinthians 9, verse 7. Every man according as he purposes in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loveth a cheerful giver. So these are the guidelines for giving. You may want to jot these down. Every man or woman should give what you have decided to give in your heart. It is an individual matter settled in the privacy of one's own heart. You don't need to go out and ask other people about what they think about your giving and how much you should give and consult with flesh and blood. That's not what Paul said do. What did he say do? Go into private with you and the Lord and work out in your heart, in private with God, decide what you're going to give. Don't consult with other people. I've heard people do this in church. How much you giving? Well, I don't know. I'm not sure how much I'm going to give to that. We all need to decide in our own hearts what to give. I need to go get with God, and I need to work out what I'm going to give for whatever the cause is, or whatever I'm going to give for church. Whatever I'm going to give to the work of the Lord, to whatever I'm going to bring to the house of the Lord. And I'm going to tell you what, I found it wonderful that when I sit down to write a check, to bring a check into the house of the Lord like I did this morning, I wanted to bring something, but I asked the Lord, would you help me in making the right decision about what to give? I don't want to give too little. First of all, I don't want to give too little. Second of all, I don't want to give away too much and not have enough for something I'm going to need later. How many of you, is that how you feel? I don't want to be him to say, well, boy, you're a tightwad this morning, Sharon. We don't want to be a tightwad when it comes to giving to God. We don't want to be giving less than what we should be giving to God. He gave his son for us. We ought to be giving our best to the Lord. So I'll tell him, I'm not sure exactly how much I need to give today, but I want to give my best. What is that? And you know, he doesn't always give me the answer like, well, write a check for everything in your checkbook. There are times that he may say that to a man like the rich man that had a problem with it. There was a rich man. His problem was he loved his money more than he loved God. So the Lord did require it of that one individual. If you sit down in the privacy of your home and ask God, what should you give? And he said, go sell everything you've got and come and follow me. You might have a problem with money. And God's trying to get you delivered from it. Some of you has got your faith in your possessions and your money. And God's going to ask you for it before it's over. Because he's going to set you free from putting your trust in anything other than him. Sometimes he will wipe your accounts out, just so you can learn to trust in him. You say, well, how can you say that? I can say it from experience. I've had times where I think, whoo, boy, we got some money over here in this account. Glory to God. I don't know about you, but it makes me feel good to look in there and it's got a couple of digits and a comma and a couple of more digits. I mean, when you get, if you got one digit with a comma and three zeros, you're feeling good. But if you got a couple of digits, a comma, and a couple of zeros, you are, man, woo, life's feeling good. I believe every man's a liar who says money can't make you happier. I said happier. Money makes me happier. But God is teaching me how to be happy when I ain't even got any money. You'd think I was rich by the way I acted sometimes. People say, well, she must have plenty. She just don't understand. See, we got to learn to be content in whatever circumstances we're in. Paul said, I've learned to abound and I've learned to be abased. I've learned to have plenty and I've learned how to not have enough. Now, he was a man of God. Now, people will tell you today preaching that if you're a man of God and you ain't got enough, oh, you're something's wrong with you. Well, go tell Paul, because he said, I've learned to be have plenty and I've learned to be without. But he said, in this, God taught me godliness with contentment is great gain. Godliness with contentment is great gain. You know, many people can't be content without money. Many people can't be content with just food and clothing and a house over their heads. But the Lord teaches us in His Word through the Apostle Paul again, with food, just with food and clothing, with such things, be content. So if all you have is your needs met, be content. If you are godly, if you possess godliness, and you have food and clothes, if you just have those mere essential things, be content. Be thankful. Be grateful to God, because He is the one who supplies your needs. He will supply our needs, church. When you're deciding how much to give, when you say this question, okay, I'm the one that's to decide in my own heart how much I'm supposed to give. So when you're deciding that before God and you're working out how much you should give, do not do it by comparing yourselves with the Joneses. Comparing yourself with everybody else. Are the Sullivans. Come on, my neighbor's the Sullivans. I ain't supposed to be looking over at the Sullivans to see what the Sullivans are giving. I'm not supposed to be looking on my left or on my right or looking at you and seeing what you're giving. I'm supposed to be working it out in my heart before God. What do you want me to do? He may tell every one of us something different in this room. He may tell you a smaller amount than He tells this one. He may tell this one everything. He may tell another one. But see, giving, He's going to tell everybody to give something. Even the widow, we know she gave her all. She gave more than everybody that gave in the room because she gave out of her necessity. The woman had two mites. She took her two mites, put it in the offering plan, and Jesus watched her. And then here comes a person gave a big old check. Maybe even thousands and thousands of dollars. And everybody says, "Woo! Look what they gave." And the Lord says, learn a lesson here. She gave more than you all, for she gave out of her necessity. She didn't have anything left to live on. When have you given your all? And you had absolutely nothing left to fall on. You didn't have a savings account. You didn't have a 401k. You had nothing left to your name. If somebody had done an inventory on what you have, your portfolio would have been pitiful. Some men boast of their portfolio. I've never had one. About the time I get something, poop, it's gone. I've learned easy come, easy go. Enjoy life. Woo, God is good. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I'm blessed to be a blessing. All God wants you to do . How many of you feel like that? Sometimes you get it. You give it to electric company. Give it to the mortgage company. Pay the grocery store. But as long as you don't get things just stuck in your hands, just become a life-giving flow. Let it flow. Sow yourself. Sow. Give into the church. Give into the work of the gospel. It's the greatest investment. God promises you this. If you will give, into what I am doing in the preaching of the gospel, I will give unto you. And you purpose in your own heart how you want to reap. Amen. This is a major word today. It's a major word. So the word purposes, every man according to as he purposes in his heart, means he chooses deliberately and makes up his own mind about his giving. Many pledge impulsively. I have to admit to you, I have sat and watched telethons on TV, on Christian TV networks, and I have gotten into what they're doing, and I have listened to them, sometimes an hour, hour and a half, and all of a sudden they'll come out with a pledge and say, call right now, call this number right now and pledge $1,000 right now. Put it on your credit card. Call right now. Pick up that phone and don't you wait another minute. That is not biblical. You are not to give impulsively under compulsion. You are not taking time to work that out between you and God. You turn that TV off and you go pray and you seek God and you ask God what you're supposed to give, and then you give after you have worked it out in your heart with God in private. I have picked up the phone and obeyed men that told me to do that. Don't you call right now. Call right now. They are pushing you to do something that's not biblical. Can you see it in black and white? It's not. It doesn't mean you don't need to give. Just because you see a preacher on TV, God may use that preacher, and you may need to send a gift. But you don't need to send nothing till you work out with God in private. You don't need to do it impulsively. So I want to warn you against impulsive giving. How many of you are impulse buyers? Do you know people put things in certain places in their store so you will impulse buy? When I'm sitting in my store, I know people like the peanut brittle and pecan brittle I sell in my store, so I put a big pretty basket right there on the counter so that when they're checking out, they'll say, "Oh, look at that brittle right there. Here, add this." And I can't tell you how many I sell because I set up impulse buys. How many of you know why the candy counter is there while you're standing in the checkout line at Winn-Dixie? Walmart. Reckon why they put all those candies right there in the reach of those children. And the children are sitting there saying, "Mama, I need some M&Ms. Mama, I want some bubble gum. Mama, look, I want a candy bar. Mama, Mama." And they even put us women a magazine there, because we can stand there and flip through the magazine, get interested while waiting for the checkout, and then we just got to buy it because we didn't have time to finish reading it. Somebody's already thought of this stuff before you. Come on. But in our giving, we don't need to be impulsive about our giving. It's okay. They're not going to die if you wait. If you turn the TV off and don't, you know, some people will try to convince you that if you don't give right then and make that phone call right then, you're going to miss God. I get really mad with that kind of stuff because it's not biblical. It's not biblical. I need to say, "God, I believe that's a worthy cause. If you believe what they're doing is a worthy cause, Father, I believe that's a worthy cause. I would like to give into that cause, but I'm not sure what I need to give. Will you help me in my decision making so that I make a sound investment and I commit myself to a pledge that I can really keep?" You don't want to vow a vow that you later break because you couldn't afford to do it, and then you wonder what happened. Sometimes they'll say, "Just pledge it. Just pledge it. Pledge $1,000. If you don't have it right now, just pledge to put it on your credit card, $100 a month. And for the next year, you struggle to pay it and can't afford to even hardly eat because you pledged without deciding in your heart first with God about if that was what He would have you to give." Don't let men do that to you. It's not wrong for men, ministers of the gospel, to encourage you to give. It's totally biblical. But this, what I'm teaching you this morning, this is how to give. It's going to set you free from giving and missing God I want your giving. I don't want you to give a penny more than God wants you to give. I'm your pastor. I don't want you to give a penny more than God would have you to give. But I also don't want you to give a penny less than what God would have you to give either. And I want you to be at peace with your giving so that when you give something, you're at peace about it. The same way I want to be. I want you to be just like me. When I give something, I want to give it to the Lord. And I want to let go of it. I've seen people give to the Lord and never sever themselves from that gift. I've seen people give, watch this, I've seen people give, despise they gave, and went back to the pastor and said, I want my offering back. And I can't call no names. But I know men that have, now that's a man that didn't do it biblically. He did not work out and purpose in his heart what he wanted to give and cut it loose and give it to God. When you give into this offering plate, you cut loose from it. It's not yours, it's God's. You say, well, oh, I gave it to Sharon or I gave it to that preacher. No, you didn't. The Bible says, give unto the Lord and from the Lord will come your reward. You're not responsible for what they're going to do with it after you put it there. God won't even break your reward if they don't do the right thing with it. If you did it the right way, they will have to give an answer to God. I have to give an account to God for what I do in stewardship here. It is a scary thing. You should try it. Imagine that you had to be the steward and decide how to spend God's money. Imagine. How many of you would like to jump up and volunteer to be that person? Because you have to hear from God and know how to steward his money. It's like he says, okay, I'm going to put you over my accounting here. And you take care of making sure it goes to where it needs to go. Some people just haven't experienced it. So don't pledge impulsively under great pressure after men playing on your emotions. Then you can't fulfill the duty or obligation because it wasn't considered, it wasn't worked out in your heart first. So I just give you that as a word of warning. Giving should be a private, not public decision, decided in the heart. And some people only give if it's in the form of public recognition. Some people, the only time they want to give is if there's going to be a public acclaim or a public recognition for what they've done. I've seen it in churches before where I had rather, if I give, that nobody knew but me and God and whoever did the accounting. I'd rather, and I'm going to tell you what, as a minister of this house, that is a sacred, sacred thing to me. Your gifts and your giving ought to be between you and God, and it's not everybody else's business what you give. So whoever's handling those records for me, whoever's handling them, is called to a sacred, very sacred, private job. And God handpicks his people for such a task. And I'm thankful for them. And if you serve in that capacity in this church, I want you to know this morning that your position is sacred. No one should be involved in that. I've heard of people, you know, somebody's over it and went and told what this one made, gave, and what that one gave. It's very personal. It's very private. Some like to have their names displayed for all to see. When they're fundraisers and different things. Well, I've been to a church service before. The Lord told us, I don't know, it's probably been a decade ago, the Lord said, I want you to write a check. And I say this just to tell you for testimony purpose. The Lord said, I want you to write a check for $1,000 and I want you to take it with you to the conference. And so I wrote the check in advance because I heard the Lord say what I was to do. And we took it to Atlanta. We took it in the conference. I put it in my purse and it stayed there. And then the Lord had the minister come up and say, There are probably over 100 people. I don't remember exactly. He was calling out a number of people that God had already spoken to your heart. He said, the Lord has revealed to me. So he had a word of knowledge. He said, I have a word of knowledge that God has already spoken to about 100 people in this room that you were to bring with you a $1,000 seed. And I went, whoa. How'd he know that? See, that's the gift of the Spirit in operation. That's called a word of knowledge. So he already knew, but he was letting us know that God had spoken it. And he knew the Lord had revealed it to him. And I was pleased with the fact that it was there. But I'm going to tell you the part that made me uncomfortable. He called us to get up out of our seat and come to the front. And for that, it just really upset me. I was almost in tears over it. I did not want to get up. I said, I don't want everybody seeing that I'm one of the ones with $1,000. That's none of nobody else's business. That's what my heart was saying. You should have just took up the offering and shut your mouth. Nobody had to see the rest of us and make us look like we were something in front of everybody else that didn't have it. There could a woman been sitting there with $10 and given her all and given more than us. And then he commenced, I think he missed God. He commenced to doing the 1,000, then he went to the 10,000. He said, there's three people in here. God's told you to give 10,000. I mean... They agreed that he was saying the truth. Yes, give 10,000. But he called them out and called them to the front and let everybody do it, see them publicly. The Bible says, don't let your left hand know what your right hand's doing. I feel the anointing of God all over me. I think I can teach the church folks some stuff. I think I need to help some church leaders learn what the Bible says about simple things like giving. If I tell you, you know, God's told me three of you are going to sow a $1,000 seed today. If God tells me that, I may tell you. But I do not believe I can be in biblical alignment if I tell you I want the three of you to come up here at the front now. Because I'm exposing you where God says let it be done in private. I'm letting everybody else look at you. They know your gift and they know your giving. And that's none of nobody else's business. Boy, I'm on it this morning. But I mean with all my heart that this is a sacred thing. I tell you what, giving of your money is giving of you. And it's a sacred thing. My goodness. We do not need to be giving with the wrong motive. We're to give as unto the Lord. Let's think just a minute. Let's consider God's gift to us. Verse 15. Thanks be unto God for his unspeakable gift. His gift was such a gift that it's unspeakable. It's indescribable. God gave his only begotten son. And people boast about, well, I gave this money. I gave that money. Let's consider what the Lord God gave. He gave an indescribable gift. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. He sent his Son to die in our place. What an indescribable gift. If we're going to boast about anything, let's boast about his gift that he's given us, not about our gift that we give for his work. He gave us the example of extreme giving. God himself gives you the example of extreme giving. God is a giver. If you know God, you're a giver. You can't know God and not be a giver. You can't really know God and be greedy and stingy. That's why the rich man, he couldn't give. He didn't really know God. He could not become a disciple of Jesus Christ. He came to Jesus and his disciples and he said, Jesus, what must I do to follow you? He said, I keep the commandments. I honor my father and mother. I honor God. I keep the commandments. I don't commit adultery. He started prizing himself on what he did do right. But he said, what must I do to become one of your disciples? And Jesus said, go sell all your possessions. Take the money, give it to the poor, and come and follow me. And when he said it, it hit the man's heart. And the man said, he dropped his head and he turned and he walked away. He couldn't do it. He really loved things more than he loved God. He loved his stuff. He loved his money. He loved his things. He couldn't part with them. He couldn't find it in his heart to part with those things that he compared its worth, and those things were more important to him than following Jesus. It's a sad story in the Bible. Turned and walked away. Many people today have walked away from God for one reason. They couldn't part with obeying God and putting their faith in God and following him and giving of their finances. There are people today who are not in this church because they could never put into the offering plate. They never got to where they could just simply by faith give to God. I've actually had people leave here, and I knew the Holy Spirit had revealed to me the reason they left. Because no matter how many admonitions I gave from the Bible, no matter how many times I taught them about giving, they would consistently hear it, walk out, hear it, walk out, hear it, walk out, not do it over and over, to the point one day they walked away and they never came back. And they went to some other church that didn't maybe teach it. Said, just give if you want to. Throw a dollar in the offering plate. They didn't teach words that he who sows sparingly reaps sparingly. He who sows abundantly reaps abundantly. Many churches won't teach on that because they know that that's one of the touchiest subjects among people and the one that makes people leave the quickest. You start teaching on money and you're going to lose some folks. Unless you promise them a lie. And it don't take long for them to figure out that that don't produce anyway. I tell you, when you give to the work of God, the fruits of your righteousness will increase. That's all I got to say to you. And I'm going to retract that. And God will supply your needs. That's all I can promise you. When you give to God, the fruits of your righteousness will increase. It's biblical. Amen? The fruits of your righteousness will increase, and God will supply not all your wants, but he will supply your needs. You can't give to God and put God first and God not do it because he's bound by his word. When I have a need, I say, wait a minute, Lord, you're bound by your word. You said you'd take care of this need. Now, it's a need. And about the time I'm in God's face for about 3 days praying about it, then here comes somebody and says, I just need to give you this. And I was like, yes! Now it goes up as a thanks to God. So not only is the giver going to be blessed, the recipient is blessed, and God is blessed. Come on now. When you start being a cheerful giver, when you start being a giver like what we're talking about here, you're going to get your blessing. The recipient is going to be blessed, and then the recipient is going to in turn start giving God thanks for you. Now, let me tell you what, when ministers of the gospel start turning around and calling your name out to God, it's on. When we say, thank you for that one that helped me. Thank you for the one who supported me. Thank you for the one who helped me to carry out the work that you gave me to do. When they start making mention of your name, that's why it says right here. Look at verse 12. For the administration of this service. What he was talking about is his ministry. His ministry. Not only supplied the want of the saints, but is abundant also by many thanksgiving unto God. So then God's getting the thanks and the praise. We're giving God thanks on behalf of those. So verses 8 through 11, there's four beneficiaries. I want you to write these down. There are four beneficiaries of charitable giving. Number one, the giver. That's found in 2 Corinthians 9, verses 8 through 11. And notice it's the first one. So if you're a giver, you're the first one that's going to benefit from it. When you give, you can expect to be a beneficiary of your giving. Number two, the recipient. Whoever you gave it to is going to benefit from your giving. Verse 12 confirms that. Number three, God. God benefits. Why? Because he gets all kind of praise and glory and honor and thanks for giving to that one who gave, and so the work of the ministry carries on. God is blessed by it. Let me tell you what, when you give, God is blessed by it because his preaching, his word goes forth. His work is done in the earth because of it. God gets blessed. And number four, the church, verses 13 through 14. Whilst by the experiment of this ministration, they glorify God for your professed subjection unto the gospel of Christ, that's what it's about, and for your liberal distribution unto them and to all men, and by their prayer for you. Those, when you give to those to supply, then it says they pray for you. Let me tell you what, there ain't a one of y'all that I don't pray for that give into this ministry, that God will bless you, God will increase you. And I don't talk about just in material ways, but yes. But I mean save your family, heal your bodies. Come on, give you peace of mind. Let you be in one mind and one accord in your house. Bless and sanctify every one of yourselves, your children, your loved ones. Bless the work of your hands, increase you, prosper you. So it says, by their prayer for you, which long after you for the exceeding grace of God in you. So four beneficiaries for charitable giving: the giver, the recipient, God, and the church. And in first place is the giver. What do I benefit? You're going to flip out when I show you this. When you become a giver, like the Bible teaches, look at verse 8. Read it with me. God is able to make all grace abound toward you. Toward who? Those who give. That you always having all sufficiency. That means enough of everything. At all times. In all things. You may abound. Abound means increase. In every good work. So it refers to the giver's unmerited favor from God. Not merited by his gift, but by favor. See, it's not your gift, it's God's favor. The word grace means favor. God is able to make his favor come to you. Hallelujah! Some of you wonder, how did I get that job? It's God's favor. It's not that you're blessed by the size of your gift. It's that you're blessed by God's favor. Sometimes, you know, persons will just come and they'll say, well, I just wondered if you would do thus and thus for me. And I'm like, that was God's favor. He's causing his grace to abound to you. You get picked. You get chosen. Someone asks you, will you do this work? I want to open up a door for you to come and do this. I'll pay you thus and thus to do this. And when you're hearing that start coming your way, that's because you've been obeying God, and God's opened up doors of grace and his favor over you. How many of you know money can't buy that? You can't buy God. Money will not buy God. But the word is true. When you become a giver to charitable giving, the work of God,
God will see to it that His favor sits on you. And He'll promote you and He'll increase you and He'll give you things that just come for one reason. Because of His favor on you. Can we boast of that? The only thing we can say is, Lord, help me to be obedient. Help me to obey You. Help me to trust You. My Lord, I love that. So the favor of God, is it here for spiritual benefits or material blessings also? What do you think? I believe it's both. Fruits of righteousness is not a material blessing. He said our fruits of righteousness will increase. Look at verse 10. He that ministereth seed to the sower both ministers bread for your food and multiplies your seed sown and increases the fruits of your righteousness. So He's not talking about just material blessings are going to come to you for giving. Some people give for one reason. Because they want a new house or they want their bills paid or they want a new car or they want to get richer. But see, He's actually talking about increasing you financially. Yes. That is part of it. Don't give and say, well, God's not going to increase me. No, His law says, give and it shall be given unto you. And whatever measure you sow, you reap. Sparingly talks about how much or abundantly. So, yeah, we establish those things by how we sow. But it's not just material blessings. It's also spiritual enrichments. Fruit abounding, increasing in goods too. Grace presents the idea of whatever one needs. Okay, let's just say as we're giving to God, today I don't have a financial need. All my bills are paid. I don't have no financial need. But just say I got a report from the doctor, and it was a bad report. Do you think God's grace could abound to you in that area? Do you think God's unmerited, undeserved, unearned favor could also abound to you in the era for the healing of your body? I've heard people say, I went to the doctor and I got a diagnosis of cancer, stage 4. And I wrote a check, the biggest check I've ever wrote to God, and took it to the man of God and put it in his hand. And he prayed for me and God healed my body. You think you bought God? Mm-mm. You exercised your faith in getting that grace. Come on. Knowing that God is able to make His grace abound to you. Hezekiah got a bad report. He reminded God. He turned his face. The prophet Isaiah come to Hezekiah. He said, get your house in order. You're going to die. Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and he said, Lord, remember the alms. Remember my alms. Remember how many poor people I helped. Remember all those people I helped. And the Lord changed his mind and gave him 15 more years to live. The Bible says if you help the poor when you're on your bed of affliction, God will raise you up. You neglect the poor. You mistreat the poor. And I will make a distinguishing mark here. I'm not talking about lazy people. I'm talking about the truly destitute orphans and the widows and those who just got a bum deal in life. Come on, some people got a bum deal because they had bum parents. There's many kids that suffer and don't eat just because of the parents. Come on. Ooh, I feel the Holy Ghost this morning. Hezekiah reminded the Lord of his almsgiving, of how he had helped the needy, how he never turned his face away from someone. When he saw someone in desperate need, he would help that one. So when his death sentence came through the prophet Isaiah, he turned his face to that wall and he said, Lord, remember. Lord, remember. He reminded God of his promise that if he would help the poor, that when he was in his affliction, that he would raise him up And God, because Hezekiah knew his promise and because Hezekiah was preparing for his future all those times before. Come on, some people says, well, I'm putting up some money in my bank account for when I get old. You can't be sure that what you've already paid in is going to be there. But if you've done what God said do, you can know this, when your time comes, you'll be able to lay up for yourself a good future. Amen? Have a good future prepared for you. God affords us the very means to be generous in the first place. You say, I'm a generous person, Sharon. I'm a generous person. I give a lot. It's God who gives you the means to be generous in the first place. So is there any boasting of self? Or again, who do we boast in? Thank you, Lord, for giving me the means to be a generous giver. Some people say, well, it was my work and my hard work and my brains that got me in there to do it. But it's God who created you. It's God that gives you the next heartbeat. See, some people just want to take all of God's glory. Well, I go to work. Well, I studied and got a degree. And now I make good money because I did all this. But if you back it up, if God had not created you, if God had not let your heart beat, if God had not given you the wisdom to go get the degree, you couldn't do it. Grace presents the idea of whatever you need, be it spiritual, be it materially, be it mentally, be it emotionally. How many of you know you can't buy peace? How many have you ever needed peace and you didn't have any peace and you were being tormented emotionally, troubled? Well, if you have a need in the area of peace, God is able to make his grace abound to you. Sow a seed for peace. I sow my seed. I need some peace. I'm going to sow in faith. I'm going to put it in the work of the ministry. I'm sowing it in the kingdom of God. And the kingdom I sow into, I shall reap from. I mean, you sow it into the Prince of Peace. He's the Prince of Peace. Amen. Can't nobody else give what he gives. Amen. You say, well, why don't he just do it? Why does he make us have any kind of work? Because faith without works is dead. True faith is evidenced by some kind of work. Let me say this. If I believe in the stock market, then I have to do something other than just believe in it if I expect to reap from it. I would have to actually sow into it and take a risk. Same way with the kingdom of God. You can say, well, I believe in God. Anybody can say, I believe in God. Anybody can honk. Honk if you love Jesus. But let me ask you this. Tithe if you love Jesus. Man cannot love God and money. He'll either love the one and hate the other, or hate the one and love the other. You cannot love God and money. You'll love one or the other. So people that say, I love God, but don't give money, they don't love God. Their own testimony of their works deny the words of their mouth. If you want to show God you love him, pull your wallet out. Open it up. Put it out there. I'm getting some amens, hallelujahs, and smiles, and some of you's got this deer in the headlights. Is she saying that? Yeah, I'm saying that. Faith without works is dead. You know what? I didn't give to the work of the Lord before I got saved. But since I've gotten born again, I see the necessity. I see the need for the church. I see the need for the house of worship. I see the need for the ministers to be cared for that are going to invest in my life. I see the need for the preaching of the gospel.
And I know that it's not free to go do it. It costs money. The gospel itself is free. But what it takes to carry it is not. What it takes to carry the gospel this morning that you're receiving, none of this around us is free. This costs money. We can get you baptized in here, but somebody had to give to get the baptistry in here to get you baptized. The sound equipment costs money. The building costs money. The electricity's running right now. It's costing us money. If the people don't give, it will become extinct. You drive by and say, "Huh, I wonder what used to be there." That's what happens to churches when people quit giving. They become extinct. When we don't give for the preaching of the gospel, missionary work and stuff, it just ceases to be happening there. Paul was a missionary. There was churches that took up money for him to go on his missionary journeys, to pay for his boat trip there, to pay for his food. So he was being taken care of by the church, but he was doing the work of the Lord. And he has every right to receive of that first portion. It's for the ministers. They have a right. Now, he was the kind of man that said, "I don't even want to claim that right, because some of y'all might think that's the only reason I'm doing it." And he hated the fact that some people would accuse him of the only reason he preached the gospel was for the money. Me and Paul would have got along. Me and Paul would have definitely got along. He had the attitude, "Woe is me if I do not preach this gospel." Money, no money, don't care. Give my life to it. God will supply my needs. And he said, "And if you give, God will supply your needs." He said, "The same God I depend on to supply my needs will supply your needs. Put God first." And that was his mentality about it. Matthew 10:8, Jesus said, "Freely you have received, freely give." So it's God who gives to us the ability to be generous. 1 Timothy 6:8, like I said a while ago, if you have food and clothes, with such things as those necessities, be content. Think about your wants versus your needs. How often are we quick to think about something we want and not mind putting X amount of dollars to something we want? But when it comes to the need for the gospel to be preached to the nations, for the local church to be there and in existence, do we think twice about putting the same thought into it? Maybe we're going to take a trip over here and we don't mind at all, just considering that it's going to cost us about $4,000, $5,000, $6,000 to make a 5-day trip and have this vacation over here. But then when it comes to the need of the preaching of the gospel, we wouldn't dare think about writing a check for $5,000 to the church. But which is most important? My want or the need for the gospel to be preached? I mean, those are things we think about. Sometimes I'll say, "Okay, God, I need a new car. But I want this one. But it cost $26,000. New. So do I need to go to the Lord and say, "But you know what? If I got one for $13,000, I could put $13,000 toward the work of the ministry and have a $13,000 vehicle that supplies my need, and then I've sowed into the kingdom of God what's necessary, plus I've reaped a vehicle that I needed at the same time." But sometimes people just have a problem weighing out the difference in the wants and the needs. And again, this is stuff you work out with God. If you get along with God and God says it's okay for you to have something, by all means, if the Lord tells you it's okay, and don't let another man judge you in that matter.
If we'll delight ourselves in Him, He'll do things for us. He'll cause His grace to abound to us. And see, God told me this one day, church, listen. I said, Lord, I need some more money. How many's ever prayed that one? We need some more money. And God said, no, you need grace. He said, did you know that grace outweighs money? He said, you can be broke and my grace can pave the way for you without money. He said, His grace far outweighs money. And this is what His desire is that His grace, God is able to make His grace abound to you. So that in all things and at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. So even in our abounding, it should be that we're abounding in the good works of the Lord. The things God puts in our heart to do. What if God should give us a desire to build a church? To buy land and build a church, it's going to cost $1.5 million. Well, we think we ain't got that kind of money. But how many of you know? If God causes His grace to abound, somebody can come and say, I want to deed you some land. Hey, that's grace outweighing money, honey. What if somebody else comes and says, I have an extra $100,000 God told me to give to you? That's His grace abounding far beyond what you can do on your own. And that's what God is saying will happen to those who give the way He says give. Become that cheerful giver. He says, my grace will abound so that you have everything you need to do, here's how it is, to do every good work that I put in your heart to do. Just say God gives me a great idea. Just say one of you come to me and you have a great idea, something we need to do to help somebody in this community. Maybe we need a training house for people that don't have jobs and they've never had proper education, but we want to bring them in, build a building, and set up a computers in there and help people learn how to go in and use computers so they can go out and get jobs. Well, we got a great idea, but we ain't got no money to do it with. God is able to cause His grace to abound to us so that we have everything we need to do every good work that He puts in our heart to do. So when God puts something in your heart to do, you say, it's in my heart to do this. And God says, that's good. I put it there. But you say, but Lord, I don't have the money. It's His grace you need, not your money. You need His grace. You need His favor. And we need to abide by His word. Give and say, Lord, cause your grace to abound to me now. So that I have what I need to do these things that are in my heart. This is how this whole ministry functions off of this right here. It's been functioning that way for years. God just causes His grace to abound. Oftentimes, it's just down to nothing. And I'll say, God, we need the house payment here for the church. We need money for this. And then God will just put it in somebody's heart. He'll just put it into somebody's heart and say, go give this, and that person will come forth and say, the Lord said do this, and I'm obeying. So God does it through people.
We hope you were blessed by today's message. For more messages, to contact us, send your prayer request, or to make donations to support this outreach ministry, go to lighthouseoutreach.org. or download our app on iTunes, Google, or any Android device. If you're ever in our area, we invite you to visit us at 9437 West U.S. Highway 84, about 7 miles west of Ross Clark Circle in Dothan, Alabama.